First World Order Radio, finally, we are on the air, no doubt. All right.
There's always going to be somebody in the building on First World Order Radio.
We get on into some of that order consciousness tonight.
First World Order Radio every Wednesday, 8 p.m.
We got to talk about what is taking place on the planet.
There's always going to be somebody in the building on First World Order Radio. First, we need to let you know we're going to be doing more shows, giving out more information on Wednesdays. Wednesday at 8 o'clock, we are now going to make this is the hottest day of the week.
Proceeding others in time, order, importance. The most prominent parts, voices, or instruments. Earthly state of human concerns in existence. An indefinite multitude, quantity, or distance. System regulates to bring about specifics in the group based on value and natural characteristics. Current radiates electromagnetistics of sound through the air, same as your thoughts transmits it. Proceeding others in time, order, importance. The most prominent parts, voices, or instruments. Earthly state of human concerns in existence. An indefinite multitude, quantity, or distance. System regulates to bring about specifics in the group based on value and natural characteristics. Current radiates electromagnetistics of sound through the air, same as your thoughts transmits it.
You need to understand how magical this, something like this every Wednesday can become. So you need to start getting your calendar right, get your schedule right. You need to know our intention straight out.
All right, so, I mean, these clues are given throughout the various languages was to piece the puzzle of this ancient mystery school back together again.
And what we plan on doing, both of us, is bringing y'all some surefire dynamite. We're going to take this level up a notch. We're going to have stuff to do here. This is not just going to be about philosophies and theories. Shit that works.
Peace. Back once again with Dr. Alim Bey, your host for First World of Radio. I'm getting ready to bring on my co-host, Brother Fahim. Are you here, Brother L?
Yeah, hi, Tay Washita East, Dr. Alim.
Yeah, Tay Washita East, brother. How you doing tonight?
Well, brother. How the brother doing?
I'm doing well, bro. We got a good show tonight. We got the Indigo Children, The Rise. The darkness is brought to the light. So the Indigo Children rise and how the darkness is brought to the light. And we're going to bring on our guest, and that's Brother Michael Pratt. Y'all might have heard him here before. Matter of fact, he even co-hosts a couple of shows. But we're going to get into the Indigo Children. We also know of the Rainbow Children as well as also the Crystal Children. These are children in which has been born since the 1940s on up to now, in which that are developing 3 strands to 12 strands of DNA. This give individuals the gifts of what is mentioned in 1 Corinthians, the 12th chapter, if you go by the Bible, for the Bible thumpers. If you go by science, then what we find out is that the DNA is changing, we're mutating, and becoming what is called Homo Christos, which means the same as Christ. From Homo sapiens sapien. There's a quantum leap in which that is occurring. And of course, we know there's a species on this planet, several in which that is attempting to stop that process from happening. So they've created certain chemicals, whether it's the chemtrails, whether it's the GMO food, which is called genetically modified organisms, or whatever the case may be. However, your intentions, your emotions, your mental attitude is what is going to continue with this process, liking it or not liking it. This is what we're going to be talking about tonight. So we're going to bring on Brother Michael Pratt. You here, brother?
Peace, Brother Alim. Peace,
Brother Pratt.
Brother L. Oh, my God. It feels good to be on the show, man. And I'm so happy and honored, you know, to do this show.
Yes, sir, brother.
No doubt.
Yes, sir.
Right. Oh, and, yeah. We was reading here, we see that there was a bio in which that we was, especially during and after the Vietnam War, many souls were told to come to this planet to help save Mother Earth. And it says, Indigo is someone who was born with an inner truth detector. Brother metaphysician, aspiring shaman Michael Pratt will share his story on his journey, how he and many others were able to use their sixth sense, seventh sense, in order to guide them to the truth. Indigo children were always on the planet, but waves of them came to the planet during the 70s, 80s, and 90s, and then other children were beginning to be born, known as crystal children, the rainbow children, as you may mention now. It says the indigo in particular are the ones who were born to tear old systems down so that they can rebuild with love and integrity. All right, so tonight we're going to say join Brother Michael as he helps spread the light and give a better understanding, understanding of who we are and why we are here. So I wanted to say that before you get started, Mike. So go into your information and let's see, you know, if people can, you know, understand what's really going on, because I know in one aspect we're becoming more crystalline. In other words, melanin is actually changing the carbon state from carbon 12 to carbon 7, in which that when the kundalini hits the pineal gland, it crystallizes and become hardened crystal, much like actually like a diamond, you know. So, you know, when we hear Rihanna's song "Shine Like a Diamond," you know, we can understand what is really taking place from more of a metaphysical standpoint. So, give us your rendition and your journey of what is taking place.
Oh, no doubt. You know, first I want to say thank you, Alim, for stoking the fire some, because, you know, we're about to begin the ceremony and just get everybody, you know, ready for the show. So, yeah, I mean, basically, we are shifting. I mean, this is obvious. You see, the energy is changing. There's so much, so many different things is going on. There's actually something astrologically going on right now, I believe. It's cardinal something.
Right, Grand Cross. Right, the cardinal Grand Cross. So which that is, right, exactly. And that's the coincidence,
yes, so,
because just last week we had the four blood moons, or the red moons, in which that even the scripture speaks about the fact in the book of Matthew and the book of Revelation, speaking of the blood of a red moon, that you would see these occur before the end of time, as they say. Of course, we understand the end of time symbolizes nothing more than the ending of an age. You know, so all of this is byproduct of us moving from out the age of Pisces into the age of Aquarius.
Yes, exactly. There's, and also Mars has been in retrograde, so there's just so many, especially with people that, you know, have, are ruled by these planets, it's, you know, it can be a little rough around the edges, you know.
Like what, has been experienced, like for those, we know that Scorpio and Aries in particular are ruled by Mars. Like, what are some of the things in which that people have spoken of, or that you may have came across?
Just different things. I mean, even people that I'm really close to, and some of my Asiatic brothers that I grew up with, their mom just started busting at me for no reason, really, the other day. All I was doing was playing video games, you know, and she just started fussing. She just came home from work and just started, and kind of made me feel like I was thrown out of the house. But thing about me is, you know, I've been practicing all these techniques, because I don't know if anybody knows, but I've been underground shaman training with Alim, so... you know, and for anybody that is just wondering about that class, you know, you just need to get in that class, because it has been just a powerful metamorphosis for me. You know, I look at before I was in the class, and now that, you know, we're kind of close to the end of the cycle, just a metamorphosis, man. So,
No doubt.
So what we've noticed with this Mars is it going in retrograde is kind of like people feel like, you know, because Mars isn't just like anger, it's passion. You know, it can be war, but usually if somebody is going to just start a war, there has to be some type of drive or some type of everybody. I wouldn't see the point of starting a war for the purpose of starting a war. There's always a bigger picture. You see what I'm saying?
Right.
Right.
So that's kind of the way I look at it. But if it's going in retrograde, it's kind of the opposite, you know, going backwards.
Do you see that that Mars deals with Aries? That deal with Alim and I, right? Aries or... Because I'm Aries, and Alim's Aries. I don't know if you're Aries or not.
No,
but,
I'm Scorpio.
But,
Scorpio, too.
Right. Right, but Mars influence in Scorpio as well as also Pluto. Definitely Mars, in this case being the red planet, as Brother Mike said, symbolizes passion, as well as also, you know, frustration, as well as also anger, you know, in many aspects. It's the warring planet in which that, you know, many speaks about. But of course, you know, as Mike said, war doesn't come without, you know, without some type of initiation.
Mm-hmm. Right.
And so that's what he's talking about, is the initiation process in which that get us to the brink of war, you know, or, you know, or to that mentality or attitude. And
right.
what we've
okay.
figured out, you know, metaphysically is that anger is stored in the liver. So, you know, anger damages the liver. And, of course, you take the R off the word liver, you have the word live. The liver has over 500 functions in the body alone, you know. So when we look at Mars, you know, we have to look at our particular organs in the body also, as the planets correlates to the seven major planets, in particular correlate to the seven major chakras, as well as also, you know, the nine planets to the nine chakra system, and soon 12 planets to the 12 chakra system, because they're discovering more. This is why they have moved up Chiron, in which that was discovered in 1977, as a planetoid, to now being a planet, you know, and they actually have moved out Pluto from being a planet. The reason why they moved in Chiron is because it is known as the wounded healer in astrology, in which that correlates to Officius, which is the serpent wrestler, in which that symbolizes the Kundalini energy, and it's being wrestled up, you know, through Tree of Life or the chakra system or the spinal column. And as it moves up, you know, of course, you receive enlightenment. But not just enlightenment, you know, you also receive those gifts of, as we made mention of the indigo crystal and rainbow children. So, you know, we definitely want to get back to that topic, because that is imperative that the audience understand, you know, this particular science.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, need to work on that anger, too, since it affects the liver. Yeah.
Right.
Mm.
Yes, I mean, anger, I mean, when you, I mean, metaphysically look at anger, just all the things, you know, if your immune system is shut down, you know, you're not in your full capacity as just a human being. So you're not even in the right mindset. That's why, you know, I was watching Bruce Lee the other day, and, you know, what he was saying is you need emotional content. Not anger, because in anger you're still unbalanced in some sort of way.
Yeah. Uh-huh.
You know what I'm saying? You want to be content, and I mean this even goes in martial arts. if you're uneasy, if you're tense or certain things, you know, just kind of like a dog. You could think of like a dog in a sense. If you go by a dog, there's something about a dog that if you, like, jerk your hand back or something to try to pet it, they can sense fear. They can sense, you know, these certain things. So you need to be content. As far as it's really good to be in a balanced state, you know.
Okay.
These are things that, like, you know, meditation, Tai Chi, Qigong, all these things are really good to balance. Because I feel, and I've noticed this on my own journey, that, you know, sometimes I get too much in the stars, and it's fun. Oh, believe me, it's fun. But, you know, I need to be on Earth at the same time. Do you know what I'm saying?
Right, right.
And, you know, what they call grounded.
Right.
So that's one of the things that I noticed early on when I got into this information is, I loved it. I loved it so much. I love being I love being in the cosmos, but you know, I need to have my feet still planted on the earth. So it's like I can logically break down to people, okay, this is some really high information, but if it's a little bit too difficult for you to understand, let me spoon feed it to you, you know what I'm saying?
Right.
Start with some baby food, you know. So yeah, basically, as far as that goes.
Yeah, that would help us prevent a lot of sickness and disease as well. Like anger affects the liver, what else affects the kidneys or the heart, the heart chakras or whatever, you know. That'd be the answer to a lot of people's medical problems.
Exactly.
Yeah.
And I mean, but there's a reason for all these certain things. It's nobody's fault. We don't need to like look at it as anybody's fault, but we need to take responsibility. You know, how have we been programmed? You know, as many men and in many mythologies and certain things, I've noticed this on my own journey, is somehow we, like, you know, unless we've had, like, a lot of alcohol or, you know, just certain things. Some people, I feel, you know, can do it easier than others, but we have this thing where it's, like, difficult for us to express our emotions.
Right.
This is not healthy either.
Yeah, right, exactly.
You see, so this is something that's very important. This goes with Mars too, as far as passion, you know, anger, still an emotion. Okay, but it's very interesting that we talk about Mars, because there's a difference between the indigo and the crystal children, and why this like resonates so strongly with me is because if you just looked at me and my life and kind of read it as a story, you would be like, this is why this dude's life was like this. You see what I'm saying? So basically the difference, a crystal child, now these are actually born later on, a little bit later than the indigos. A crystal child has this passive, you know, very Christos, Christ-like, Buddha-like nature to them. Like, for instance, if somebody hits even when they're younger, if somebody hits a crystal child, they'll be like, why would you hit me? I'm your friend.
Mm-hmm.
They completely embody the higher self. They're just that way, naturally. They are what we should strive towards, I feel. A much more balanced state, And here's another instance. Say you have a child or something, or, you know, a younger kid, and there's this long line, and people just start pushing you to the back of the line. Now, I mean, most people would say something like, hey, man, you know, like, I was here first.
Right.
But a crystal child would just get pushed all the way back to the line and won't even bother him.
Mm-hmm.
He or she will wait until, you know. Now, that's the highest self.
Yeah, it has to be.
But,
yeah.
But to be honest, me, I couldn't do that.
Right.
You know, I mean.
I have to stop somewhere, yeah.
Yeah, stop somewhere. Now, it doesn't mean, like, I'm going to fight him or anything. It's just saying, like, yo, man, I was here first. What's going on? You know,
the first one, the second one, maybe, but the third, nah, wait a minute, hold on now, you know. Right.
Exactly. So that's the crystal child. Now, the indigo, now it's interesting because what we say, Aline, indigo is the color of the psychic chakra, the third eye.
What we refer to it as, or... there's many terms for it.
Yep.
It looks like the night sky.
Yes. Yes, exactly. It's very interesting because this whole thing correlates. I can remember just being, now this was like 1999, and I'm in like kindergarten, and I'm just coloring with this. I'm just coloring like Anakin Skywalker and, you know, this just drawing, and I look at the crayon, and I remember it still to this day, and I was like, I love this color, and it was indigo, and it was just something about that, just that, something about it, to what resonated with me was just very strong, you see, and so, now, I was the kind of kid, man, that I was just rebellious. I was just, you know, just teachers, you know, I was like their worst enemy. I didn't mean to be that way. I didn't want to be that way. It's just how I was. Mm-hmm. I was just like kind of, and it's not really even, I'd get in trouble for, you know, silly stuff. I'd be, like, constantly daydreaming. You know, they have what they call, like, the moment of silence, a certain thing, let's give a moment of silence. And I'd be daydreaming. You know, my attention was always out there, you know.
Yeah, I had experience like that myself.
Exactly. Now, I don't believe I had ADHD or certain things, but these are some of the common symptoms that some of these particular children have. Some of them, you know, my mom works with a lot of children that have autism and Asperger's and all these different, you know, they call them disorders, but really, if you look at it, what we're talking about is new children being born with kind of different nervous systems. Different ways of perceiving. You got to see, these children aren't, when we look at it, say, from, you can kind of sum it up like this. We'll use the chakras. Say, you know, when the Native Americans, you know, basically, you know, the Moors, everybody was doing their thing and had their land.
Right.
There was a homeostasis. There wasn't any problems. There was a time of peace, you know, like they always say in Avatar. There was a time of peace. And that peace is what we long for, honestly.
Right.
But when you look at it, when we fell down from a state of consciousness, you can even look at it, you know, you can look at certain... I don't want to say maybe the 40s, 30s and 40s, I guess you could say. you can kind of look at it like a chakra. So, and this is actually basically, you could say, like 30s and 40s maybe were more associated with the root chakra. Or I mean, maybe even 50s, you know, and you could say that basically they're more concerned was towards, say, security and being secure and basically having their ends meet, you know, their whole life was focused on, you know, more so materialism, more materialistic goals, right?
Mm-hmm.
So we can look at it like that.
Right.
And you could say the 60s and such like that began to be, you could say, like the orange ray. You could say, you know, constantly, you know, sex, drugs, rock and roll type thing, you know, and basically, and we just keep going on from there. So, but by the time you get to the 90s, we're talking about, and this is something very, very clear. And there are actually indigos that were born, you know, I mean, even that were just kind of here to kind of just check the planet out to make sure it, because this new energy is not anything like the Earth has ever seen before.
Right.
We have to understand that. This energy is something that is completely there to tear down old systems that don't work, that have never worked.
Right.
And rebuild it with love. You see. So, I mean, they're what they call scouts. So anywhere, say, from the early 70s, 80s, there were actually indigos and I would say even early crystal children that came to the planet just to make sure that the planet was okay. You know what I'm saying? I would probably say like Brother Wayne Chandler, you know, basically they were always vibrating on this information, but they came here just to make sure the planet was okay. And it was later in the 90s, we get to the 90s. The 90s, I don't know, I would say, Brother Aline, did you ever feel there was, like, this strong consciousness that just began to, like, open up during the 90s?
Oh, yeah, no doubt. No doubt. It came through the music via KRS-One,
Four Righteous Teachers,
X-Clan, Public Enemy, Big Daddy Kane, the R, known as Rakim, the God, that was in the late 80s, early 90s. And, of course, you know, it kept coming on more with, you know, the 5% teachings and known as the Nation Gods on Earth, as well as also with the answer to Allah, Nubian, Islamic Hebrews, known as now as the Nuwapi or Moor. Up under Dr. Yorker, who was known as Imam Isa at the time, that teaching infiltrated the music dramatically in the late 80s and the early 90s. You know, so then, of course, you have Nas,
right,
you had P-Rock, CL Smooth, as well as also Wu-Tang Clan, you know, the Grave Diggers. On up into the late 90s, you know, with Killer Army and different other, you know, I mean, the whole 90s, late 80s, 90s, all the way up, you know, to the 2000s, you know what I'm saying, was straight consciousness, you know, in a sense, and that's what people were drawn to, even though, of course, you know, people also like Biggie and also like Tupac. Tupac, of course, was more conscious. And he put out conscious songs too, even Ice Cube. So a lot of consciousness was during the 90s. And so everybody who was teens and adults during that time who liked hip-hop rap music was definitely drawing in order to go and research and find out more information during that time period. I mean, that's just what it was, you know. So we had music in which that was influencing us, you know, ridiculously. So, of course, you know, you have more Indigo Children, being born in that particular time period, you know, or not just being born, but, you know, coming into consciousness and into awareness, you know, becoming more universal in their standpoint and looking and searching for information, you know. So definitely.
Yeah, I was going to say the music is definitely a strong part. I look at it like a puzzle. They all kind of add to the whole. But also movies. I mean, you got to check out, you know, the movie Ghost. All these different movies begin to, it seemed to me, at least, they became this whole psychic thing. Instead of something that was held, you know, underground, began to open itself and began to be talked about and shown, you know, more often. You know, movies, shows that were like, you know, they just said it in the movie. They said it in the shows. And this is something I feel, particularly in the 90s, that these shows just began to just surface up, you know. And the important thing that I say is because of that is because when the Indigo Children are born into a society that is just completely, you know, left brain, and they're having all these experiences, and they don't know how to deal with it. And, you know, they go to their parents, and the parents thing is just making them it up, or it's like a monster under the bed or something like that, and don't understand that they're really dealing with spirits. They're really dealing with actual, you know, phenomena happening to them, and they have these gifts, and they have all these certain things, and, you know, people don't understand, teachers don't understand, you know, even psychologists, and, you know, I love the concept and the study, you know, of psychology, but even psychology, you have to look in the soul to kind of really know what's going on.
Mm-hmm.
You see, so you know these children are born, but many of them volunteered or, you know, put it in contract to come here because, you know, the planet was just too much after you know the Vietnam War and all these certain things. There's so many people, you know, praying. Asking their higher selves, you know, I need an answer, I need help, you know, and the Indigo Children are like, yeah, all right, you know, we can come down and help.
Right. Did these children come from other star constellations, such as the Pleiades, Sirius, different different systems in which that Arcturus, in order to, you're talking about a soul journey, and them, I guess you say incarnating or incarceration into the physical body was something of which that was going to be, you know, a benefit to humanity. You know, where do you see the Indigo, Rainbow, or Crystal Children? Where do you see them, you know, actually doing work at? I mean, what are they doing now on planet Earth? As you say, they were, you know, there was prayers in which that was put out, you know, in the 60s, in which that brought forth, this real incarnation of or massive amounts of this energy by the 70s, 80s, and 90s.
Very good question. Basically, you got to look at these kids. These kids aren't regular kids. And I speak this for myself, but I speak this for all the ones that I've met and all these things. They each have different gifts. Some of them you know, are there to be the, you know, the Martin Luther Kings, the Malcolm X. I mean, even JFK. I mean, they're activists is what they really are, and they're pissed off. And a lot of times they get in trouble because of this existential anger that they have. And that's why they're so misunderstood. But the thing about it is they're angry for a good reason. Like we said earlier, you don't start war for the sake of starting war. They're angry because they know that something's wrong with the world.
Right.
That's why they're angry. And they're really here to, I don't know any way to put it, you know, kick ass and take names.
Mm-hmm.
But
yep.
Only because that, you know, and we're not talking violence here, but we're talking about creating change.
Right.
And many of these children are born to a system. Even me on my journey, born into a public school system, and this, you know, was my worst enemy when I was, my two things that I dreaded when I was little is school, public school system, and the church.
Wow.
To be honest, to be completely honest, I was kicking and screaming. I didn't want to go. You know, but because of the way I felt, I knew the way I was going to feel there, you know. And like I said, many of these children are not, you know, they're very right-brain oriented. They're very creative. I mean, you may think that the kid knows something and he could be painting a magnificent picture. And you wouldn't even know because you're just like, you're looking for his intelligence in places where he doesn't even really care. They're very quick learners. You see, so they're really activists is really what they are. So honestly, man, I mean, if I put a rant about all the things that I'm pissed off at, the GMOs, at the chemtrails, you know, just the way the whole government has been, the way that the people have been lied to. These are the things that upset, say, an indigo. You see? So, really, they're because they're so pissed off about things, is how they kind of say, like, this is how I know I need to. I know I'm here to change something.
Right.
Now, what I'm saying, this is not an angry or pissed off that's gonna like hurt you in the sense or shut down your immune system. Because I don't want people to think that.
Right.
But it's an anger because they know things are wrong. They know systems are corrupt. They know that people are being lied to. They know that people are being brainwashed. You know, they know something's wrong with the world. And behind that anger is love. You know what I'm saying?
Right.
So that's really why a lot of them are labeled. And, yeah, I mean, even myself, you know, that they're non-compliant, that they don't want to do things because they come from, you can look at it as in terms, you know, what they call the dark ages. If you sum it up kind of with the energy that was around it, you can kind of look at it as like greed and competition. The type of thing like is, you know, I need to get mine before you get yours.
Right.
There's not enough to go around. See, the indigos and these children are born knowing that they can manifest things, that they can make things happen, that they, you know, I mean, you can, you do work, but I mean, you can manifest things. You can. They know this, you know, deep and internally. So they know that cooperation is will get you further than competition. That's why they, you know, even myself, when I look at the television, I look at all this media, and it's just like, all everybody's doing is having, like, a big damn ego fest. You know what I'm saying?
Mm-hmm.
Nobody
right.
really cares about changing anything.
Well, they want to leave it as it is, the same as it is. Leave it the
yeah.
same. You know, they don't want it to evolve. No.
Yeah.
Because when you evolve, things
exactly.
will change. Things
you know, or what the... I mean, I guess they call that, what, conservatism?
Right. Exactly.
Well, this is what Albert Einstein told you. If... One does the same thing over and over and expects different results. He called that insanity.
Right. But, you know, when how they term it, you know, anytime you talk about advancing or dealing with the evolution of things, you know, you're talking about change and, like you said, conservatism. All conservatism is about is to keep people stagnated.
Yeah, I mean, if people really wanted to get to the definition of, you know, what they call conservatism, they would go back to tribal, you know, setting.
Mm-hmm.
I feel because at least then I mean, I'm not saying as in the point where, you know, I mean. There's so much technology, like some of the roles that maybe may have been very necessary a long time ago, you know, aren't really as necessary now. But I'm saying, you know, there was a point in a medicine man giving back to the community, where he was able to go on a journey to give back some helpful information, some useful information. Everybody had a purpose. Everybody had a path.
Mm-hmm.
You see, and when you're born here, it's just like, if you ask a question, it's like the Matrix. It's like, well, you know, all these things, did they happen? And it's just like, what does that mean? But the Matrix can't tell you who you are. And it really can't.
Right.
If you ask the wrong person, they might say your destiny is to be working at McDonald's, you know? This is crazy. And some people actually believe that that's all they're worth, that's all they can accomplish. So the indigos, and let me put it this way, everybody has a life's purpose. Everybody that incarnated on this planet has, you know, what they call a life's purpose.
Right.
And so that's really what the indigo are trying to help everybody remember, is that, I mean, you can work, you know, in certain jobs to get you here and to get you here, but ultimately, you do have a life's purpose. And this life's purpose is basically, they call it like, it's part of your soul contract. None of this is by coincidence. They say, you know, before you incarnate, you set up a contract. Basically, what you came here to learn, the lessons you want to learn, but also, you know, what your purpose is. You see?
Mm-hmm.
Right.
And that's why, and many of these indigos are not actually children anymore. I mean, they're around, you know, a good portion of them were born in the 90s, so, you know, I mean, they're about my age or maybe 25
right.
or older, you know. So when we talk about the life's purpose, it's because this is when, you know, all the currency will start flowing if it's never flowed before. And you know, when people tell you that thing, like, you really need to follow your heart, I don't care what anyone tells you. If you follow your heart and what they say, your passion,
right?
That's the only message that you need. You don't need anyone to tell. You know, some people do give good guidance, and don't get me wrong, but some people, you know, I mean, it's like you're playing chess with a pigeon or something.
Right.
It's like, you know, like, really, come on. You know, so that's the thing, and kind of the thing in the Matrix is like, everybody's here to know thyself, but that knowing thyself is a, as it unfolds, there's this mission, there's this calling, and everybody has this. And I believe that's why many people, you know, are not necessarily in alignment with that because, you know, of programs that they've received from their family and friends and, you know, certain, you know, I guess you say authority figures that have, you know, kind of told them that, you know, their dreams are not important.
Right. Like, yeah, a lot of them just kind of dreams as well. That just some part of your sleep, you know. You know, it ain't, it don't mean nothing, you know. It just, you know, forget about it.
Yes, no, believe it or not, that's what my grandma told me. And then I was just like, not my grandma on my mother's side, but my grandma on my father's side. You know, I was just like, you know, dreams are really important to me, and I gotta, you know, figure it out. And so, you know, dreams are very, very important, because if you're gonna watch a movie, you can watch your dreams.
Right.
Because dreams are basically movies, and if you sit like somebody in a movie theater, you're able to kind of watch it and see, oh, okay, this is what's going on. Honestly, man, at the end of this thing, at this end of this life, I bet it's going to be this gag reel. You know what I'm saying? But we have to play under this illusion. You know, but I bet you it will be this gag reel where it'll be like, starring Brother L. You know?
Mm-hmm.
Is, you know, and people just laughing at each other because they're just like, we really that, like, hell-bent over this? You know? Really. It would just be laughing at ourselves, but now it's just like, oh, this just feels so real.
Right.
So that's kind of the illusion, you know, that we're playing under. And I'm just so thankful to be born in this generation, because like I said, like, I got born right into, I mean, I was born, you know, 93. I believe that's when the Wu-Tang Clan first came out.
Mm-hmm.
You know, I was born right into this, you know, information. You know, I mean, just all these shows that I was watching, you know, as a kid, just like, it gave me confidence to just like, yo, you know, like, this is you, man. You can do this, you know. And especially the Matrix. You know, I mean, I was really young when I saw that movie. But if you ever see that movie, I mean, you watch the Matrix, right? The
right.
First one.
Right.
You ever see when she's like, Neo, wait right here, and, you know, he's waiting in this room with these kids, and basically she's like, she calls these are the other potentials.
Okay.
Okay, basically in that scene, what I got is actually, I don't know if they knew it or not, or knew what they were doing, but those are actually the indigo and the crystal children. That's actually, you know, how they're born, how they start out, how they, you know, that's them.
Okay.
So there's so many powers, there's so many things. Alim, have you, I don't know if you've heard of the story of Lemuria. Have you, could you go into that a little bit? Because from what I've heard, this whole thing kind of like starts from Lemuria.
Yeah, well, of course we know when all the continents were together, it was called Pangaea, or what is known as Asia, which means body. As they begin to drift apart, of course we heard of the continental drifting, which had occurred around 200 million years ago. During that split, there were still areas or land masses in which that still existed, and that was above the water, in which that you had Hyperborea, you had Atlantis, as well as also Lemuria. Lemuria, based on what is said by the brother of Albert Churchward, James Churchward, in his book called The Children of Mu, he states that the pygmies, known as the Twa people, was on the Hawaiian Islands over 2 million years ago, and that was actually known as Lemuria. Of course, after the sinking of Lemuria, came from volcanic activity, in which there are some portions of what is known as Hawaii under the waters, and now we have the Hawaiian Islands, in which that is left, in which that is in the chain. But there was an actual landmass in which that all of that was actually tied together at one time, in which that historically was known as Lemuria. After the destruction of Lemuria, they came to the landmass known as North America, Central America, South America, and also into the Caribbean islands. And actually, Atlantis was a landmass of the various territories there, such as Haiti, Dominican Republic, Tobago, Trinidad, as well as Jamaica, Cuba, the Bahamas, all of that at one time actually was one large landmass known as Atlantis. That also sunk underneath the portion of it sunk underneath the ocean, in which that they have found right off the coast of Cuba, actual walls and pyramids and different other structures underneath the water, as well as also roadways in which that they have found, in which that's called the Bimini Island, as it was called, or the Bimini, in which that, you know, was there, in which that was part of the linking in of that landmass called Atlantis. So Atlantis did sink, as suggested by Plato, in his, as well as also Aristotle in this story, when they speak about the Grecian tale of Atlantis, but also that Grecian tale came from off the walls of ancient Kemet, in which that the ancient Egyptians also taught that it was a landmass in which that sunk underneath the ocean, in which that was westward, their location of westward of Africa, the continent itself. So all of these tales have been told throughout, you know, various stories and various indigenous people tradition. So Lemuria had people there, Hawaii had people there over 2 million years ago, documented by James Churchward specifically in his book, The Children of the Moon. So it would do well for us to, you know, examine, you know, what actually took place and, you know, what was really going on. Also, if people get my book, The First World Order, I go into detail about Lemuria and how the people was there, in particular the Twa people, in which that actually populate the majority of the islands known as the Ocean Islands. You know, So you would see the Twat people actually all around the world, and they spread out throughout the diaspora of Africa. And so we see the same thing, you know, connected, you know. And so Lemuria was the place in which that allegedly came forth portions of our consciousness, dealing with symbolism, dealing with the allegories of these various stories in which that we now find within the Egypto, Metroneter, comedic writings, hieroglyphics, as well as also the Sumerian tales, as well as also the recordings of the Mayans, the Olmecs, the Incas, the Aztecs here within the Americas. You know, so it's all one mystery school system in which that once dwelt. And the language at that time, based on what James Churchward said, it was called the Naga, or the Naga language, which is the serpent language.
Wow. Very interesting.
Yeah.
Yeah, no, that is exactly what I was saying. Actually, you have to read this book. This is a very interesting book. She's very well studied. She's a great author. And she was actually a clairvoyant as a child. And basically she was born to like a kind of a metaphysical family. This is a good book that I've been reading. It's called The Care and Feeding of Indigo Children by Doreen Virtue. And it's an excellent book, but she goes into there. Have you heard of her, Aline?
Of course. Mm-hmm.
Okay. I was like, she has some excellent information. I mean, she's not really that new age. She's more metaphysical, and she kind of does, you know, basically that type information. So she writes in there, in Lemuria, it was a time of peace. It was a time of peace where people were, you know, not eating animals. It was a time of peace where everybody was, there was a homeostasis, very balanced, very peace, you know, very, I'd say, everybody was, I mean, of course, civilized, but they were very, you know, I mean, generous and kind of like, you know, they say in the Avatar, you know, it was the time of peace. And everybody, kind of like, you know, like Zion, like they say Zion in the Matrix, you know, kind of think like that. So, you know, supposedly this is what Lemuria was, you know, until it came into contact, you know, with, you know, these beings that were more savage-like, and they kind of somehow, yeah, I don't know necessarily what happened, if they mixed or what happened, but the original beings from Lemuria began to kind of, you know, they began eating meat, and they began, you know, basically doing all these things that weren't their original nature. And so what happened was, and she says this in the book, but basically, you know, degenerated from, you know, the peace-loving beings that they were originally in Lemuria.
Hmm.
And some of these are what they refer to as the Atlanteans. And there's also other things that you can put into aspect. Some of these people, you've got to kind of look at it. Of course, the Indigos, but just people in general. Not everybody is in that sense, a 100%. They do have a human body, but there's differences. In other words, there's people that are more, they you can just kind of tell that they have, you know, fairy, they look like they could have came from the fairy world or something like that. they're star people. I mean, honestly, I believe, you know, I believe I'm you know, a star person. I believe, you know, Alim, you know, it's a certain type of thing is kind of like that you just know based on, you know, who they are, what, you know, they enjoy, you know, that type of thing. There's different. There's incarnated angels instead, you know, angles of light or, you know, and these people, you can see, if you've ever, you know, known, say, a woman or something that kind of, like, she always tries to kind of, like, save people, you know, kind of in the sense of, you know, if they're, you know, they could be a drug addict or something, but she's trying to save them. She keeps trying to help them, even though, you know, sometimes they don't even listen.
Right, okay.
That's, you know, a lot what they call, like, an incarnate angel. You know, so there's different, and, I mean, there are few, believe it or not, of beings that are just, you know, basically 10, 20% human. You see? There's nothing wrong. I mean, even if you look at the etymology of the word human, it means soil. So even to be human, you know, it's funny. We're star beings by nature. This is something that's like, you know, I mean, it's obvious. See.
Mm-hmm.
So, I mean, so basically human comes from the word humus, I believe, which means soil. So where do we get this soil from? You know, where does this come from? It means that we had to have came from another place to get here. And, you know, and then we have people that tell us that this isn't home. Or actually have people try to make us believe that this is home. It is home in a sense, but from what I've learned on my journey, that Earth is really a school. You know, nobody really lives at school. But you come here to kind of study, check it out, you know what I'm saying, and, you know, basically. But nobody really lives at this school.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, have you ever met anyone like that, brother?
No, I haven't.
You know, nobody lives, you know, at school. So it's kind of like a temperamental place to kind of study, in a sense. You know, you go to a bookstore, you go to the metaphysician, or, I mean, you go to the metaphysics section, you're not going to stay there all the time. You're just going to grab a book and, you know, probably go back home or sit down on a table and read, you know. So, I mean, we look at that, it just really, I feel, puts things into perspective. You see what I'm saying?
Right.
So, but just like the thing with the indigo, there's many beings that have come from Sirius to teach us. There's many beings that come from the Pleiades. I mean, there's many star systems.
Yeah,
indigo, you know, one thing I've mm-hmm.
Indigo, I'm going to cut you up and shelf and things like that, but indigo, isn't that where the term Indian come from?
Right, from the word Indian, white, right, then which that indigo means blue, black, or black, right.
And that's why a lot of the Europeans was calling Moors Indians at one time.
Right. Right.
Yeah.
Well, that was the common terminology during the time of so-called Christopher Columbus or Cristobal Colon, which, you know, some say he didn't even exist. But regardless, during that time period, you know, 1400s, 1500s, that was a popular term when they seen dark-skinned people to refer to them as being Indian.
Okay.
Yeah, but let me say this too. Before we go on, I got a lecture coming up this Sunday in Atlanta, Georgia. It's going to be at 1386 Ralph Abernathy, Atlanta, Georgia, 30310. We're going to start at 4 p.m. The admission is $10. All right. So if you want to come, check me out. I'm lecturing. So you know how we do, all right? So once again, that is Ralph Abernathy, Atlanta, Georgia. That's 1386 Ralph Abernathy, Atlanta, Georgia, 30310. Starting time is 4 p.m. Admission is $10. So, you know, also you can call 404-396-3429. That's 404-396-3429. That's Circle and Point Production. And so that's going to be held at in Shumray, Hathora, 1386, Ralph Abernathy, Atlanta, Georgia, 30310. Brother Nasi, who whooped up on Sarasota and Seti, he's hosting it for us. So definitely come check us out. Once again, 4 p.m. Eastern Standard Time, be starting, admission $10, donation, whatever case is. So just give us a call. You can also call me for more information, 910-364-9099. That's 910-364-9099. All right, Atlanta, Georgia, we in the house this weekend, this Sunday. All right, this coming Sunday. All right, check us out.
All right.
In the building. Yeah, no doubt. All right. Brother Liam, did you have any questions? I'm still going in, but
No, I don't have any questions right now.
All right. Okay. So, you know, basically, what this is about is these concepts. These are just concepts, but it deals with rising a feeling in you. If anybody has read the book, which I suggest, very much suggest, Bringers of the Dawn by Barbara Marciniak. Very good book. Alim turned me on to it. And these are the teachings of the Palladians. Now, the interesting thing is, as far as the Palladians, what they teach is all this higher information that they seek is to raise a feeling within you to get you to kind of realize your own truth. It has to do with raising a feeling. So all those high, vibrational words, things that you hear, is to raise a feeling in you.
Mm-hmm.
Not so much to be concerned with the high vibration of the words and all the, intellectual and long words or words that they're using. The only reason they're speaking like that is to raise a feeling within you. See, because feeling is, they even say this in the book, your five senses, some people base their whole reality upon them. Your five senses is what is the illusion of really your true sense. Your true sense is feeling. Okay? So this is what I was able to use, ever since I was a young child. Even when I saw the 9/11, I was in like second grade. And, we all got called basically go sit in this one room. And I'm like, for what reason? We all get called to sit in this one room just to see this thing happen and to just see a plane go into a building. Being born into that just made me realize you know, this shit is not working. This things are not the way it's supposed to be. In the own country. It's supposed to be the land of the free and the home of the brave or whatever.
Right.
You know, but you see this, you see a plane going into a building. Now, it took me a while, I'd say probably till I was about in eighth grade or so, to, like, have the wake-up call. You know, I was drinking tap water, you know, I didn't know all these things, you know, at the time. I was in eighth grade, you know. But it took me a little while. But I always knew there was something about those planes going into the building, and even when I watched as a little kid, I couldn't, it just didn't look real. It just looked like I wasn't even able to handle or understand, you know, what was going on, you see. So this inner detector is, you know, what we've used, and it's kind of this, it's kind of like a bullshit detector. It's just like, you know, bullshit. Like, I know, you know, you hear this dude talking, and all you can, like, hear is just bullshit, bullshit. You hear it on the news, and you just, like, you know that this is not right. But anyways, what people were able to do with 9/11, which is actually this big sacrifice ritual to get everybody to think in one particular reality. But the Indigo Children are just like, as horrible as that looks, what if we can do this with love? What if we can get everybody to look at the same TV screen, reality, the box, you know, and in a much higher vibration? Because that's the lowest of the polarity right there.
Right.
You know? So this is the thing, you know, that we know we have. And so it's just like us being born here, it's just like we get all this thing about being, you know, patriotic and all these certain things. And it's like, how much more patriotic do you want us to be? You're talking real patriotism, you're talking about Native Americans. To be truthful.
Right.
Because, you know, this isn't the Pilgrim's Land.
No,
I mean, honest. Yeah. So, I mean, and I'm just saying, you know, I mean, to call people illegals and even certain things that they call with Mexicans and certain people, it's just outrageous. This whole thing has, I feel, it's lost its meaning. And I feel that's why many of us are in the planet to give. She says this in the book, that basically she calls them, you know, we're renegades, members of the family of light, but we're here to bring the meaning of human existence back to the forefront. Because if we think about it, if we leave this place where everybody is in harmony, at a much higher consciousness, then people won't have to be like, well, Earth is so bad. You see? And it's got nothing to do with Earth. There are certain rules and there's certain things that makes Earth the way it is. But Earth is not the problem. It's the ego. It's the constant, yeah, basically ego, but this so much of the diversity and certain things that separate people. You see what I'm saying? So basically, when we talk about that, we're talking about if we leave this planet in unity and we leave this planet, it's basically, I mean, you look at it and just, how can I make this place better before I go home? Nobody wants to leave the day feeling like they did a bad job.
Right. No.
You know? I was just saying this today. I mean, I was just kind of saying, you know, kind of just saying what I feel, but I was saying, who the fuck doesn't want to go to heaven? Like, you show me the person Who doesn't want to go to heaven? Like I'm saying, you're saying all these religions and fighting and all this, but who doesn't want to go to heaven?
Right.
You tell me who. I mean, like, it's so out of whack, it doesn't even make sense. It's
right.
Just like, oh, you think a person would just want to go to hell for the sake of going to hell? That doesn't even make sense. Now, I'm sure the homeless man would like to go to heaven.
I'm sure. Oh, yeah, no doubt.
The prostitute would love to go to heaven. Yeah. So, if this comes from lack of education, and this comes from not using proper judgment, I would say, because even if you took it in the context that, you know, this Yeshua, which I guess you said is truly Imhotep, right, Alim?
Right.
If we even look at how this guy was, if he ever existed, this dude was the most unconservative, radical, liberal to the core, pacifist kind of guy. So it's got nothing to do with America. It's got nothing to do with this whole patriotism, this whole type of thing, you know, I love my country, I do well for my country. That's not how this dude was. This dude spoke Hebrew.
Mm-hmm.
So it's just, a lot of misinformation that gets people to think and kind of misplace the whole point. See what I'm saying? Yeah, this Imhotep wasn't this type of person that, had anything against anybody. You know, this is the higher self. This is the crystal children. This is where we're talking about. I've noticed, but we also got to look at it as far as the crystal children and the indigo children. When I look at it from, how I've evolved, since I was a child, is why a lot of them seem to be, so hyperactive. It's not only because the energy, the kundalini, is just rising, but the foods. You know what I'm saying? The foods, the nutrition, plays a very strong part, I feel, in the basically why they are the way they are, why they're hyperactive, why, they don't want to listen, why they, are causing problems in school, that whole thing, I feel, is because of the diet. Or, we don't want to use the word diet anymore.
Right.
The nutrition.
Yeah.
Mhm. The nutrition. Oh, go ahead, brother.
Yes. It was it has a lot of effect on your attitude and causes mood swings, anger. Getting back to anger, that too. And that's a lot of things we want to work on. In order to prevent this anger, our eating habits and dealing with holistic health, contributes a lot of this anger prevention. Too much anger, but everybody gets angry once in a while, I guess that's part of us being spiritual natural beings, But, it like sickness, disease, heart disease, kidneys, high blood pressure, dealing with hypertension, high cholesterol, and the like, Even cancer, So it the foods we eat and a lot of it cause a lot of us to act in a certain way outside of our character,
Very true. No, I mean, that's No, that's very true. Basically, like when we talk about the nutrition, and I look at it, you know, even in my own life, and the reasons why it seems like, you know, I mean, I could never sit down. You know what I mean? I don't feel I was hyperactive, but my attention, I had a very short attention span. So certain things I would get into, say, you know, I would be into this particular art, and then something new would come out and would just, like, make it seem like this art is so much better than this one, whatever it was, you know. And then it'd be like my attention would be from here to, you know, whatever was hot, you know, at the time. So when we look at it, that now many, right, many, like, you know, attribute it to, you know, sugar. But one of the things that she mentions in this book is the lack of serotonin. And this is something that, like, I've noticed tremendously on my journey that helped, is just, like, basically, you know what I mean? We need to get more serotonin. If, you know, kids are seeming to be hyperactive or, you know, these type of things, by exercising, by jogging, all these certain things, because serotonin is like the feel-good hormone. Now, you can get this from drugs, but, I mean, you can do this naturally. So, jogging, you know, exercising in some form, these all help to raise the serotonin. And I noticed that when I was little, and she even mentions this in her book, is that basically it seemed like I was that way, you know, but when I'd be home, when I'd be watching Dragon Ball or something, or when I got into Taekwondo, I felt my energy was more balanced.
Okay.
See, because I'm a water sign, but it's, you know, people usually have in their elements, there's usually two elements that they have that kind of are a little bit more dominant than the others. So for me, I'm a water sign. So, I'm supposed to be peaceful, relaxed, you know, type of thing. Really, you know, I can be emotional, but also there's a fiery part, and that fiery part was just like, I need to balance, you know, the fiery part, that indigo part is the part that needs to be more balanced to, you know. So when I started learning Taekwondo, when I started learning these more Eastern arts, you know, they call, you know, basically I felt a lot more centered and balanced.
Right.
And, you know, when I was little, I wasn't really thinking about my nutrition, you know.
Right.
I mean,
right. No,
it's just,
at that age, no.
Yeah. I mean, you're not thinking about high cholesterol and, you know, all
right,
these certain things. So, but when I began to do these arts, now, I didn't know what Tai Chi was or Qigong was. Well, consciously I knew because I was watching Dragon Ball, but I didn't know it was possible yet, you know. So I was doing Taekwondo, and I felt a balance. You know, there was, I was much more balanced. And I noticed even myself when I was younger, you know, I would grab, you know, like sodas. I would grab, you know, chips and, you know, cookies and, you know, all these certain sweet things, you know. I had like a sweet tooth, you know what I'm saying? So these things would, I find out later, to correlate with, you know, being hyper, you know. You see what I'm saying?
Mm-hmm. Exactly.
So basically I had to find a way to balance and relax And the public school system taught me, you know, only about till freshman year. Freshman year was like when I said, yo. I mean, that's when I got into hip-hop, really. But as far as, like, trying to take it seriously and things. But as far as around that time, it's kind of where I said, like, yo, this system is lying. I know it for a fact. I know this isn't true. You know what I mean? But even when I didn't even seem to try, it seemed naturally, like, I was like, I don't know, pop a leg butt up in the classroom or something.
Mm-hmm.
You know, I was chaos, man. And not that I even really wanted to be, it's just how I naturally was. And chaos in the sense is just what you tell me is just like, I know that this shit isn't right. I know this isn't true. I know that, like, Christopher Columbus isn't the guy that you're portraying him to be. I know that all this is, you know what I'm saying?
Right.
Or not.
Right. Some people say that even if he did exist, some historians claim that he was a pirate. So, you know, the man ever exists, no. But the name wasn't Christopher Columbus. The name was Christopher Colon and so forth, you know, where Columbia is named after, supposedly, you know, in South American
wow.
continent. You know, so as
no,
far as,
I mean,
as a miracle dispute is concerned, there's more people saying the man didn't exist, you know. So I know what you mean about the lies, even about the monetary system of this country, you know.
Well, there's so many lies, and I mean that's the reason why I feel we're here. You know, some people just want to stay in the light, and you know, just want to be like, you know, we can just, you know, stay and pray, and things will all be good. But you gotta understand, people in the highest position are occult practitioners. So you have to get into it in order to kind of decipher and figure out how we can, you know, bring the darkness to the light. In the highest
right.
position, they're occult practitioners. They're doing sacrifices. They're doing all types of crazy shit, you know? And so that's why the Indigos are here, you know, just to kind of say, hey, man, like, stop it. Like, you've got, like, little boys. little
mm-hmm.
boys. Running, or thinking they run the world, thinking they run these systems. But if you tell a little boy, you know, stop it, you know, they're a little boy. You know, so that's really what I feel that we've got to do. And the thing that is different about the Indigos, this is the thing I think. I believe I've heard, I don't know, I've heard some, I think it was Brother Panic, I think, said on the show, is just all these certain things, like, you know, all these things are going on, but, like, at the end of the day, what are you going to do about it? Now, that is true, you know, many people don't do anything, but the Indigo Children, the way their nervous systems are built, they are so about who they are that is just like, no, I'm going to do something about it. That's why
right.
I'm here.
Mm-hmm.
Now, like I said, we can't save everybody, but if each person does it, like the 100 monkey theory, you know, it gets to grow wider and wider and expand, you know, this message. You know, we can't save everybody. And we can't really save anybody. It's more of something that they have to realize on their own. Like in The Matrix, when it says, unfortunately, no one can be told, but the Matrix is, you know, something you have to see for yourself.
Right.
And that's the thing. Like, you know, I mean, we get into all these concepts and things and calling people conscious people and all these certain things, but we got to think, like, these are all just English or Latin or Greek terms that we're using to describe people when, like, you know what I'm saying? They each have a soul. So it's just like we've got to kind of, at least from what I've seen, is, you know, basically just realize that and just realize that, like, you know, it's more than just these terms. Everybody is here, you know, I mean, you know, that has souls, I would say, that wants to elevate the consciousness of humanity. You see? And there's people that are born, you know, just like, you, I mean, Bruce Lee, you know, who's with his philosophy and able to combine that. And you, I mean, that's why he was here. That's what he was doing. We look at it in the sense that that's why we're here, you know. Maybe not to, you know, be the masters of kung fu, you know. But,
right.
I mean, we could, you know, but what I'm saying is each of us has a particular energy that you can kind of look at, and this energy is kind of like a signature of kind of like what you're here to do. So if you have healing hands like Alim, I mean, Alim already knows he's a healer, you know?
Right, exactly.
So, but what I'm saying is there's archetypes, there's roles of the healer. There's certain things that, you know, the community needs a healer, the community needs this type of person. We're all, what I've realized is we're all playing roles in this movie, you know? Even as the Matrix. You know, when somebody's trying to get a message to you really important and this person just can't shut up,
mm-hmm.
It could be Morpheus trying to wake you up.
Right. Trying to give you a red pill.
Yeah. When a person is constantly, you know, telling you, you know, you need to get a job and you need to get this and you need to do that. Mr. Anderson. So we're all playing roles in this great film, you know, we call life. And it's really, from what I've found, and I've heard this before, and it just feels so true to me, is that there's two paths that you can take. And you can kind of just look at this. So even though we do all have flaws, but you can kind of look at this and discern. If there are two paths, one is the path of love, and the other is the path of fear. This is how you discern, and you feel with the heart. So when somebody's saying something, if it's important to listen to that particular person, you have to look and discern for yourself. Is this coming from a place of love, or is this coming from a place of fear?
Right.
You know, is this coming from a place of love, or is this coming from a place of fear?
No.
Doing sure right now, Mom.
A lot of people get confused the two, or loyalty and fear and love, all that confused.
Exactly.
So, you know.
And this is one of the things I've learned. I mean, it doesn't really matter. I mean, when you look at a person, you just meet them or you just don't really know them, you don't really know the whole story. So, I mean, it's just like when it comes to the discernment, it's just that's how you feel. You feel from the heart. Like if you know a person's heart, you can just kind of say, is this coming from a place of love, or is this coming from a place of fear? If it's that fear feeling that you like, you know, if this dude is dreaming black and white, you know, then, you know, it's just like, okay, I'm good, you know. But if it's coming from a place of love, then it's just like, no, you can go, you know, and you can, and you know you can trust that person. And you know that they only want what is best to become the greatest version of yourself. Now, I mean, mm-hmm. that's what they call the higher self. Right, Brother Alim? I don't know if he's still on the air. Basically,
he's probably in the chat room, I guess. Maybe.
Okay. Yeah. But basically, you know, that's what they call the higher self. The higher self is, you know, people have many different concepts of it, but it's the greatest version of you. It's Prince in his prime. It's, you know, it's, you know, Wu-Tang Clan when they dropped their first LP, you know, it's the greatest version of you.
Mm-hmm.
And one of the things that I've actually understood, and it's helped me, because being the Indigo, honestly, man, this is why that, it, you know, people see me on Facebook and certain things. And it's just like, you know, this dude is just like the most non-conforming person that, like, I know. But that's the role I'm playing. I don't want to conform to anything. You can't put my ideas in a box. I don't want to be in a box. You know what I'm saying?
Right.
And why people say, you know, I have, you know, as far as people that are extremely religious in certain things, that, you know, why sometimes I feel I have to butt heads with them.
Mm-hmm.
It's not for the sake of butting heads. I realize that that person has life and comes, you know, from the same source, but they're just so stuck in the illusion that it's just, I can't listen. So from what I've learned is to be a little bit more polite in that sense, because nobody likes to get offended, you know what I mean?
No.
Nobody likes to feel like the Grinch, you know, before Christmas, you know? And this is one of the things that, like, I've found in my life, is when you apply the Bruce Lee thing of absorb what is useful, disregard what is not, and add your own.
Mm.
And this is something that I've seen Alim do, like, you know, that's what it is. When you add your own, this is even really add your own, but we said when that eye be single and the body shall be filled with light, the people didn't catch on to that, but Alim is like, no, that's the pineal gland.
Yeah, especially when you say adding your own. Yeah, adding your own.
Yeah.
Nothing like that. Nothing like it.
Well, tell me where you've heard it, you know, from TV that someone's ever said something like that.
I don't.
Go to the preacher and, you know, no disrespect to Joel Osteen, but go to the preacher that says, when the eye be single, the whole body shall be filled with light. Tell me the one preacher that even says that and finds that important to say.
You're not going to hear it.
You won't hear it, even though it's in there.
Churches, synagogues.
Because that's what they're doing. That's what they're doing.
Churches, synagogues, boss too, you know.
Because they may not follow Bruce Lee's teachings, but they, what? They absorb what is useful to them, disregard what they don't want, and then add their own. See? And then that makes it a system. See, but if you take what Bruce Lee was saying and make everything that is practical, meaning you can pray, and that's practical, and it works. you use what works. If it doesn't work, you know, you experiment like a scientist.
Right.
If it works, use it, of course. Honestly, more power to you. Like, use what works. Disregard, you know, what is not useful. Like I said, when Alim was saying, the heart. Well, when you tell me Moses split the Red Sea, what can I do with that?
mm-hmm.
What can I do with that? I mean, it's colorful and beautiful and pretty, but what can I do with that?
Right.
Oh, he split the Red Sea. Well, good for him, man. Teach me how to do it. You know, but when you say, oh, no, this applies to the thing that's keeping me living, it applies to my bloodstream, my heart, that's practical. That's practical and within every human being. So it's practical and it's useful. So you can absorb that. All the things that you learned in science class, you can absorb that because it's practical, it's useful, and it's in you. You see? So when you get down to the basis of the allegory and see what it was actually talking about, that's what everybody's reaching for. People don't understand secrets because nobody takes the time to actually figure out, you know, what could this be about? No, they just want to hear the story.
Oh, yeah. Say something to make them feel good.
It's hypnotizing.
Yeah.
Have you ever, you know, like, say, like, somebody was reading to you a Mother Goose story or something, and you fall right to sleep? You know?
Right.
A Mother Goose story. Or just telling you the story before you go to bed. It's hypnotizing. It doesn't tell you to question. See, the indigo is the one that questions.
Mm-hmm.
When I was younger, my friend's dad, he used to get mad at me because I'd always ask why. Why? Why? He said,
yeah.
You don't ask why. I said, why don't I ask why?
Right.
And why do you feel obligated to ask? To tell me why to ask why when all I want to do is ask why? Is it why a letter? You see, I was that, you know, philosophical kind of dude, and the dude is just like, well, because you just don't say it. You don't ask why, you know?
Huh.
And that's just a down, if you agree to it. But if you just never get satisfied with the answer, you know, it will kind of put you on a path where it's like, I've got to discover it for myself. This is, you know, I'm better off talking to a
mm-hmm.
a pigeon, you know. I get better, you know, advice and wisdom. So when we put that, and also something that if you look at the movie, I think it was Enter the Dragon, and when you hear Bruce Lee saying, don't think, feel, is like a finger pointing towards the moon.
Mm-hmm.
Don't concentrate on the finger or you'll miss all that heavenly glory.
Right. I remember that. Yeah.
I feel that is exactly what Aleem's message has been. It's just
mm-hmm.
like you get so caught up. And, I mean, it's my message too. It's just like you get so caught up in a character, you forget the whole point of what this dude was actually trying to... And the character didn't even have anything against you. May not have even existed, but may have not even had anything against you. And when you look at it in that context, it's just like, you know, it's kind of like the Little Mermaid. You know, Garfield. Did
mm-hmm.
Garfield have anything against you? And you kind of look at it like that, and you're like, everybody, you know, you've been led astray. You've been hoodwinked, bamboozled.
Right.
And over Garfield? Over
Garfield.
You mad at Scooby-Doo. You mad at... Wait, but he didn't do anything. Honestly, when you look at it like that, and you're just like, it's not their fault. Because one, they may just be an imaginary character that somebody envisioned in their head.
Mm-hmm.
Or, if they did exist, maybe based off historically on a particular person, but has nothing to do with you. You see what I'm saying?
Mm-hmm.
So it's just like how you have to kind of look at it like that. And when you look at it like that and you say, you know, don't concentrate on the finger because you'll miss the whole glory of the moon. It's just like, honestly, man, you're here on Earth. You're here on an assignment. So you get concentrated on the character, you forget your assignment.
Yeah, that's true.
You get distracted.
That's right.
You get distracted, bro.
Right.
You know, this whole Matrix is designed on getting your attention.
Exactly. Off of what you should be on, yeah.
Yeah. And remember, the only way that people could separate people is by divide and conquer. The only way they could separate people is by convincing people that it's really something between them. But who's the puppet? Who's playing this game here? Who's pulling the strings? See, when you kind of look at it like that, and you realize, oh, that's the easiest way to blame my friend, my brother, you know, but it's got nothing to do with them. It's got to do with a system that lacked integrity, or that has been misinterpreted, or that has lost its meaning. See, when we talk about practicality and all the people saying love thy neighbor, how many people will you see practice that? Because you'll get a beautiful feeling if you're practicing love thy neighbor. Oh, yeah, you'll get a beautiful feeling.
Right.
So you'll know you're doing it right. Well, why do you love thy neighbor? Oh, no, because I want to be a good human being. Got nothing to do with the books. Love thy neighbor.
Mm-hmm.
I'm saying do unto others, you know, as they have them do to you. Well, I mean, yeah. You know? So take what is practical.
Right.
You know, certain situations, you know, it just depends. And it's, and the thing that has been detrimental is when people have taken these things literally. You can't just say, you know, that when people read the Holy Quran or something and say that people are just extremists.
Right.
Oh, no, there's other extremists, believe me. There's people that have taken the thing literally about the whole thing of if thy eye something misleads you or something, pluck the other eye out.
Right.
And someone would take that literally. Now, you got two eyes for a reason, bro.
There's
you got
no
two
doubt.
Eyes.
No
you got three eyes, matter of fact.
No doubt.
But those two eyes are very important. Okay, so when you take these things literal, honestly, can you say that this dude is coming from a place of love if he plucks his eye out?
Mm-hmm.
No. You never hurt anything when you come from a place of love. Hurt comes from a place of fear. And what did Yoda tell you? What did Yoda tell you in Star Wars?
Mm-hmm.
Fear is the path to the dark side.
Right.
Fear leads to anger. Anger leads to hate.
Yeah.
Hate leads to suffering.
Yeah, and all that causes diseases and sickness.
Yes. So you got to listen to this dude was speaking wisdom. Yoda. See, so when we say absorb what is useful, we see, the Matrix is very practical. So we can absorb that. We can absorb what Yoda's saying is these things are practical. This is what I'm saying is if these things bring you to another level, then you know, okay, I can listen to this. This makes sense. I can add it to my life. So when Yoda says that, have to think about it. If fear is the path to the dark side, now, the dark side is necessary in order to get to the light. So there is a need for, Darth Vader. But that's only because Darth Vader forgot how to love.
Right.
You know what I'm saying?
That's why they call him Darth Vader. He went dark.
Yeah, because, honestly, Anakin was the chosen one from the beginning, and was the chosen one, but he got distracted and forgot about his mission. So Luke just passed him up, and Luke is just like, well, I'm everything that you wanted to be, but, you got with the dark side a little too much.
Right.
So
what happened?
There's a balance. There's a balance. See, the thing is, all these powers are true. All these things, we can do them. You can make things levitate. You do have telekinesis. You do have these things. And when I was younger, I'd be like, oh, hell yeah, you have all these powers. But now that, I've learned and I learned what they can do and how powerful they are, I realized that thing is true. With great power comes great responsibility. You gotta be careful. If you can, not only you may freak some people out, but you could hurt somebody, you have to be careful. You have to only use them when they're, necessary. Now, we do need that rise of the power. Don't get me wrong. But I'm just saying to use it in a way that comes from a place of love,
Mm-hmm.
Because if you have all these powers, one of the things is that comes with it is just as beautiful as you can heal somebody, you can also, do something that may not be, the best, So it's just we have to kind of look at it in that context and just realize, yes, we have all this, we have all these powers, but the best thing we can do is to follow the path of love, because love is always going to guide you to your heart. You can look at it from this sense, right?
Right.
With the place of love, honestly, man, your dreams, your
right.
passion,
mm-hmm.
what you love to do. Now, if you just take, just say a regular, guy, and just put him in this desk, put him in this office,
right.
Put all these papers in front of him and says, you have to do this, you have to do this, you have to have this done by a certain hour. Look at this. this is something that was just created, just a scenario that you just created in the mind.
Mm-hmm.
But look how the perception has changed. First of all, if I was that guy, I'd be like, nah. There's other things that could be doing. It would be more productive, and this is just not me. But I've noticed this in my own journey. Is have you ever heard of what they call Ivan Pavlov?
Yes, I heard of it, yeah.
Yeah, basically, he came up with what they call classical and operant conditioning.
Mm.
So, and I think I remember Alim or Brother Panica talking about this one time on the show, and basically, I remember this when I was in school, and I might just have sparked got just right into the learning process. But as soon as I feel I'm about to learn something, the bell rang. That bell rings. You see? But the thing about it is when you hear a bell, it's just like if you hear or you smell a certain perfume, say from a girl or something, it stimulates your nerves in a way that makes you feel a certain way. Honestly, it's just a bell. But
mm-hmm.
as long as I was in the public school system, I felt this feeling of, oh my God, I gotta go to school. And it's just a bell. It has nothing to do with school.
Well, it has something to do with control.
Because
too.
I associate it. Yeah, because I associate it with school. Mhm.
Yeah, the bell. Yes, the bell. You hear him in churches. You hear him. The bell tolls at noon, and the school ring, and you can get up and go to another class. You know, it deals with control like whistles. You know, same thing.
Yes.
You know, it's amazing how deep the mind control thing goes in society. You know.
Mm-hmm. I remember that, man. And so when the bell rings, you automatically shift from what were you thinking to this feeling of, at least for me, it was a feeling of dread. It was like, I was like, okay, what was I thinking? I could eat this today, I could eat this. And you hear the ring, and then it's just like, gotta go to this class to learn some shit about stuff they don't know.
Mm-hmm. You know? Exactly. Mm-hmm.
But anyways, I'd have to, you know. And so that bell, and it's interesting. Now, they say this is how it was in Greece, and I don't know, that much, as far as Greece. But when they say the original word school came from what it says is that school was actually a time of leisure.
Mm-hmm.
It was a time where people who were devoted to study could have leisure, have fun, talk about. And now you think of how much it's degenerated, and you look at, when you feel that, when you hear that feeling of the bell. Think about that. The definition has completely changed. Or they've tried to make the definition change, but the definition is actually as it always was. They just try to put their own signal on it and change it from its original meaning. But school actually means leisure.
Hmm.
Educate actually comes from the word educare, which means to bring wisdom from within.
Right.
And this is one of the things that I heard actually in that Palladium book is that this is not a lifetime where you're going to learn new things, really. This is a lifetime where you're going to remember who you are. So things from past lives, all this wisdom that you have, you can bring that in I remember my teacher at the time in first grade said, I can't even find this dude's reading level. Now, I'm not bragging, but I'm just saying, basically, you know, from past lives, if you look at it, it's just like, this dude, you know, this little guy.
Right.
There's more than this little guy.
it's nothing to be regulated. It can't be regulated. You know, can't be graded. You know, it doesn't have a grade. It doesn't have a degree, you know.
And that's just the thing, though.
You know, that's...
That's the thing, though. We are actually limitless beings. We're actually limitless beings. Whenever we put ourselves into a box, we're limiting who and what we are. Even, don't get me wrong, and you know, it's important to know, at least in this reality, nationality and all those different things, but it's not even a small fragment of what we actually are and what we're capable of. This is stuff that you, just by default, just by being from the stars, these are just things that are just naturally. You know, if you look at it, say, you know, when somebody makes a catchy song, whenever it sounds good, everybody's just like, oh, yeah, that sounds good. And they're amazed because they've never heard somebody make music like that before. But before, they said, you know, it kind of sucks and, you know, all this. They don't really want to hear it. But as soon as it sounds great, people are jumping all over the place making it seem like it's a masterpiece. You see? It's because people haven't really seen it before. You see, Reiki and all these energy modalities, you know, honestly, man, what that Yeshua is doing, or, you know, if he existed, would that not be what he'd be doing? Is Reiki? Now it's just that we have a word for it, and it either sounds mystical or, you know, now there's a way to explain this magic trick. But... you see, there's, whenever you have a word for it, it's not as, it's caught in a way. It's caught and it kind of, you give it a definition and then it's almost controllable. So, all these different things. When you tell people, when people say you need to be educated, they say no. I need to be educari, bro.
Right.
I need to be educari.
Right.
I need to bring wisdom from within.
Within, and that's what it actually means. But they don't. They put some into you from them, you know, from their system.
Yeah, and we know they're not following Bruce Lee's philosophy. Because if they were, they would have been saying, oh, we know they're not. We know they didn't watch Enter the Dragon. You know, maybe some of them did, but if they were, they would have saying, I cannot teach you. I can only help you explore yourself. That's a true teacher. Because the way that a person is born genetically and the way that maybe they'd be better with, you know, hitting this way or they'd be quicker with their feet or whatever, that all goes into play. And just when you look at it, it's just like, if you're helping someone explore their self, you find out what is best for them, or they find out, because they're only looking within.
Mm-hmm. Exactly.
And this is what I've found. Some of my greatest realizations, light bulb ideas have come from either meditating or being in, you know, some type of, you know, sleeping, dreaming. Even being awake, you know, sometimes. But sometimes when your attention just drifts a little bit and it's just you get this idea and it's like, damn. You know, and that light bulb flashes and it's just like, oh, it's a new invention, you know. Like, Eureka.
Right.
It's like you got a new invention. You got a new, you know, the light, you know, something. Something, you know.
Mm-hmm.
You, so, I mean, and these are really what they are. I mean, inventions were so popular, you know, during that age, but when we look at it and think, well, this educari is really the invention, the wisdom from within. And that's really what guided me along the path that I've took, you know, so far. And some people will say, you know, they don't understand. They're like, you went a really weird way. You didn't go train with yogis, or you didn't, you know, learn from a traditional. I was like, yo, I learned from Alim, man, and I've known
right.
him 5-6 years now. I didn't have to go to India. I didn't have to go in the Himalayas. A dude from Brooklyn, Harlem,
mm-hmm.
a hip hopper.
mm-hmm.
I didn't have to go, you know, the Himalayas to find out that what I need to find is within myself.
Right.
You see? And so, you know, and they all point, and this is one thing that I realized, even if you're at Pizza Hut right now, and, you know, I do feel sorry for you, but, you know, I was at Pizza Hut at one point in my life.
Oh, yeah.
And I dreaded it, you know, but I was just, I guess, happy because I got a job. But honestly, I mean, we look at it and just like, how does pyramid building go into making pizzas? How much have we really lost?
mm-hmm.
Well, we're just too lazy now. it takes a lot of energy just to make a pizza now.
Right.
But, you know, like, really, we have to kind of think about it and just realize how there's so many things. There's, I mean, the other day I had a glass of Soleil, which is basically Himalayan salt and water in this kind of solution, but it has, you know, like 82 minerals. And I felt so energized and just alkaline just by that alone. And it is solar energy. So all these different things, we have to look at it as, are the ancestors returned? But the thing is, just like kind of Luke, you know, when Luke started out, and he was just like, I don't know if I have what it takes to be a Jedi. I don't know, you know, if this is my life. Everybody kind of starts out like, you know, I don't know how to use this lightsaber, man.
Right.
Everybody starts out like that. So we got to kind of be patient with ourselves and realize that, you know, we can't really be too hard on ourselves for not knowing how to build the pyramid. You know, it's something we'll come to, I feel. And maybe it's just, you know, pyramids aren't as necessary as they were at one point in time. But we're learning, you know, we're still learning how to use that lightsaber. We got to be kind of patient with ourselves. When we look at it and just kind of, instead of just saying, you know, just adults, and just kind of look at it like each of us has this, like, inner child that is always there. And if you eat this kind of food that you ate when you were a child or you did these kind of things, there's no way that you're not going to either love or the inner child is not going to respond. You know, when you have nostalgia, you know, that's like the inner child. You know, certain things. So, I mean, really got to look at it from that point. But what I feel is, in this journey in particular, We're remembering everything. We're remembering who we are. But I feel by at least the end of the journey, we'll get to the point where it's just like, right before we were born, we know the whole story. It's like a story that's like chapter by chapter, you know.
No, yeah.
Added on each day, you know, the best that we can. But we've got to follow the path of love. We've got to follow our intuition. We've got to follow spirit, because that's what's going to guide us into the things that we love, and meeting the people, you know, what they call synchronicity, meeting people that is just like, oh, you were saying that? Oh, I just thought about that. And, you know, this is how people find their soulmates, you know, their twin flames. You see, this is, you know, this is very real.
Right.
And I believe everybody has, you know, many complements or a soul, an aspect of their soul in another being, you know, whether it be masculine or feminine.
Mm-hmm.
So, I mean, just basically all these things, and when we kind of just, like I said, absorb what is useful, disregard what is not,
mm-hmm.
add your own, that's kind of how you be like water, in the sense that you get your own style. But it kind of came from absorbing what works and disregarding what is not practical. You know, you know, doing the splits in somebody's trying to mess with you, doing the splits or something, may not be practical, you know, so it just,
right, no.
It depends. And, you know, I would hope nobody got in that situation, but I'm just saying, just, you know, I mean, basically, you know, hypothetically.
Mm-hmm.
So what is practical? if somebody is, I don't know, just deciding to be a jerk or something and messing with your girlfriend or something, is it practical to, you know, bust it out doing the Michael Jackson? We gotta think, is this practical? But when you look at this as in religion, you look at how silly does that sound?
Right.
How silly does that sound?
Mm-hmm.
You're saying you pluck the eye out and doing a Michael Jackson move, and this dude is like trying to mess with your girlfriend or something.
Yeah.
Does it sound
not rational?
Exactly. That's what it comes down to being. We need to be it's good to be metaphysical. We have to add the rational part to kind of give like a floor or grounding, so it's just like, yeah, we know what we're talking about, and we can explain what we're talking about, and if we have something that comes through with the intuition, we can explain it logically, so we have a mix between, you know, the left hemisphere of the brain and the right hemisphere, so it makes sense.
It does.
So, I mean, when you look at that, we got to think about what is practical. If we use that allegory that I gave, or not allegory, if we use basically what I gave, is it practical to do the worm, you know, when somebody is, pointing a gun or something? Is it practical?
Mm-hmm.
Got to kind of look at these verses, scriptures are kind of like this. Now, of course, you know, nobody wants to attract, you know, that situation or something, but I'm just saying, think about how silly it sounds. Where are you at? What are you doing? you know, I mean, we got to kind of look at that. And, so, you know, and I will say something else. When I was discovering this, I was volunteering with my friend Andy to help. And basically we were helping basically, you know, children and kind of adults who had, you know, disabilities. You know, what they call disabilities, disorders. We were helping out them. And it's just so interesting just to be in so many different worlds. It's just like, here I am on, you know, Blog Talk, and there I am in a world, you know, where, you know, it's just kids or, you know, adults with, you know, many disabilities, and you just get to hear so many different perceptions of life and realize that they all matter, you know, to them, of course. And, you know, this dude had his iPod, and basically he was just like, I don't want to, you know, I don't want to put anything that has, like, you know, cuss words or something in there. I was like, all right, give me this, bro. Just give me a minute. I'll get it popping. And I put on Grandmaster Flash, the message. And they could have been disabled as much as you want to say. But these people could dance. I saw myself doing moves that I never, you know, imagined that I, you know, would do. You would see. And, I mean, there were African brothers and sisters there, too. And what I saw even there is, even if some of them didn't even like to talk or didn't know how to communicate, because, you know, some of the people there had, you know, what they call autism and certain things. They could dance. They didn't forget how to dance. Nobody forgot how to dance. You
right.
See what I'm saying? So, so it's still there. Even, you know, with people that have disabilities, that love is still there, that, you know, and I don't really want to say that they had disabilities. It's just the way that, you know, maybe they were born or certain things. But getting to spend time with them kind of just, oh, it humbled me to the core. It's just like if somebody ever thought that they're egocentric, they need to sit down with these children, these adults. Or they think they don't have an ego. They need to sit down with them and just let them teach you. Let them teach you.
Mm-hmm.
You know what I'm saying? So it's just, it's wonderful to see life from so many different perceptions.
Right.
But the thing about some of these were adults, but the way they acted were like children. And it just showed me that this whole age thing, it's all in the mind.
Right.
And that's what it showed me, because they're playing on the playground, and they're supposedly in their 30s. They're playing on the playground, you know?
Mm-hmm.
But I can guarantee you that they're not mad at the TV or mad at, you know, whoever, so-and-so, Fox News. I can guarantee you they're not. I can guarantee you they're not scared of the Illuminati.
Right. I guarantee
so
you that,
see,
too.
They're so innocent, they don't even know. So it's just, that's the thing. It's just like, that's what it just showed me. It's just, you got to get to the place of innocence and come to the place from the heart. Like, that's, like, I feel the greatest message that if people are going to try to give people a message that really clicks, is just, like, when they say that in all those Disney movies and things, they're not kidding, man. You got to, heart knows. Even I think, you know, in you look in Egyptian, what is it? In Egyptian civilization,
mm-hmm.
the heart was always more important than the brain.
Right. It weighed on the scale.
Yeah. And so they even threw away the brain, I believe, and just kept the heart. The heart is what gets you. And, I mean, fields have been shown that the heart has probably the strongest electromagnetic field in the body. So that heart, the heart chakra, the heart is that place where you get to where it's just like all the walls come down. It's like everything you even thought you knew about life and you, like, I'm about this, I'm do this, and everything that you built, all the walls that you put in front of you, they all come down when you come from the heart. And that's the beautiful thing, because it kind of clears up the illusion.
Right.
Kind of just lets you say, well, this may be, you know, Ra-Im-Hotep on Facebook, but what is he really, you know, about in reality? You know, how is he actually, you know, like? You know, so it's just you kind of, it's like the real character, it's like the mask is taken off. You kind of see the person for, you know, the true colors, you know, who they really are. And so that's the thing about the indigos, is that they will rip your mask off. If they feel you're lying. Because they can only sense when somebody's lying.
Mm-hmm.
And that's really what they're upset about. And many of them, actually, what Alim mentioned earlier about Chiron is the wounded healer. I feel many of them, even on my journey, we get distracted. And we start out as the healer, and we have these great intentions of what we want to do and accomplish on the planet. But someone hurts us, and then it's like a wound. And then sometimes we even take that pattern that the person did to us and then kind of like, you know, push it on the other person. When really we're supposed to be the big brother.
Right.
We're supposed to be the big person. That's like one of the things that I realized. And, you know, I mean, just so many things on the planet and so much distraction and different things. It's just like, but who's going to decide to be the bigger person? Are we going to sit around and argue about this and fight about this? Or is somebody going to say, I'm Sam, sorry. I didn't mean to. So, I mean, I feel that's something that's like really important. One of the things that Bruce Lee talks about when he's talking to Yip Man, Yip Man says, never go against nature.
Right.
Never really be resistant to anything. Kind of flow with it. So kind of just follow the punches. Just go and bend, you know, and flow like water. Because water adapts. Anything, you know, it can fit any container, you know, it's the softest thing on earth, but yet it can penetrate any rock, you know. That the whole thing that Bruce Lee was saying is water philosophy. I feel is, you know, is what we need during these times, and many of these things that we we see these leaders are, you know, what were leaders, you know, mainly, you know, like heroes. And we say, you know, so many of them are gone, you know, and but when we look at it, maybe it's not for us to be, you know, that leader in particular, but to be like, you know, a Martin Luther King, or, you know, we each have our own journey, but just kind of like, or, you know, Bruce Lee, or, you know, whoever, you know, and just kind of look at it as like what they did in the time that they were alive to spark something in us, spark something new in us that will, like, you know, it's a new creation, a new idea. You see? So, I mean, this is really kind of like what I've, you know, just observed, you know, in my journey. And I'm only, you know, 20 years old in this physical matter.
Right.
But it doesn't mean that the information is not important. You know, I feel like, you know, I feel like if somebody, you know, I already have a beard, so, but, it, you know, if somebody, I don't know, made my hair gray or something, they'd be like, oh, it's more believable now, you know, and if I had a cane or something.
Right.
Look like Papa Legba or something, they'd be like, oh, I believe that now. Oh, no, because you're 20. I can't believe what you're saying. But, no, this is, you know, this is the truth.
Yeah.
The best is what I can say on my journey. And,
right.
I mean, I don't know. I mean, how do you feel, Brother L?
Pretty much the same way. When what you're saying, that it shows and it tells me that I'm have done the right thing, because I've been on mine, you know, in all my 61 years, you know, being on the planet. I have made a lot of mistakes in my younger years, you know. And when you at the age you are, I've never been at that level. No, I was far from that level. So I can imagine what are you going to be like when you get 61. Man, wow.
Ooh. Wait, what are you saying? You're saying at your age, you weren't?
No, when I was your age, I wasn't, no. No, I wasn't the cognizant as you are now. No.
Oh. Well, I mean, it's really just like I see it as, you know, I'm just doing my best to do my mission. You know, my name is Michael, so I have to, I do my best to, you know, live up to my name, but, I mean.
Mikey L.
Yeah.
That's you can look at it that way, you know.
Some people say Mikey L,
you know.
Yeah. But, I mean, I would say, Brother L, it's because we all have different journeys. You know, I may be really good at this information, but if you just throw me in the middle of a tennis court, you know, I may not... I might not do as well.
Well, you know, well.
But that's because I haven't been practicing, you know, tennis as
right,
long as,
right,
you know,
exactly.
This information.
Right.
So, I mean, it's really, yeah. But the thing about it, I feel, is that this information that we have, we're not getting distracted. You know what I'm saying? We're out of the age of the martyrs and certain things, and it's like I said, you know, we won't put up with the bullshit. I'm sorry.
Right. Mm-hmm.
And personally. It's nothing to be mean about. It's nothing to show off. It's just that as a true human being, we search for truth. You know, we want to know how things really happen. And so if we believe the lie, it's just like the person that lied to us was either, you know, uneducated or very manipulative and just, you know, wanted to do it for their own gain, which that's the worst, you know. I mean, with a person lying just, and they know they're lying, you know. But, I mean, when we kind of look at it like that, it's just like, I feel this information, if people are proactive with it, and, you know, instead of making, you know, like, protest signs, you know, like they did in the 60s,
right.
If people are active with it, and, like, you know, they're practicing the Qigong, they're practicing the Tai Chi, they're practicing and being practical, then I feel like they can only transcend. Because honestly, when we look at it here, this comes from the Pleiades, and I'm sure it's from, you know, the constellation of Sirius and all the constellations. We came here so the planet doesn't blow up, man, because it would affect a lot of other systems. So think about it. If we think about it in that context, say somebody who's from Sirius.
Mm-hmm.
That makes people worried about the Sirius system, because if planet Earth blows up, and then it's like it has an effect on people who's chilling in Sirius.
Right.
It has an effect on people in Pleiades. So we can look at this as kind of like, we may not have been as Earthlings as, you know, we thought we were, but it's like we came here to, I think they say this in, I think that dude Cypher says this in The Matrix. He says, so you're here to save the world. What do you say to somebody like that? You know?
Mm-hmm.
It's crazy.
Yes, it is.
And yet we're the chosen ones.
This is a lot of madness. Yeah.
But the whole goal has been to get the chosen one off his path or her path. See, the interesting thing about the Pleiades is one of the things that you say that they notice that they have a very strong feminine energy.
Mm-hmm.
The thing is because they've worked really hard at balancing the energy, because if you look at here, it seems to be more towards patriarchy.
Oh, yeah, it has been for years. Many years. Many, 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 many years. Yeah.
You see? And the woman gets no respect, but yet the woman brought us here. That's a contradiction. How does she not... Honestly, to be honest, I mean, physically, she's more powerful than the man. You see?
Yeah, she always have been. Yeah. Patriarchal, when you're dealing with just about even religion, you're dealing with a patriarchal, system, you know. Reading the Bible, you've been with patriarchal, you know. Women done everything wrong. Man had nothing to do with it. You know, it goes on and on.
Mm-hmm. And we look at that, and we look at that as the divine feminine. But because of the absence of, say, you know, it's not making men more feminine. It's just them realizing that you know, all we are is energy. And there's, each person has more, you know, towards a masculine or a more feminine energy, but we have the both, we have the two within us.
Mm-hmm.
You see? So, I mean, it's really about the balance of the two energies. You know, and it's like, we look at that and we see all these things, and you gotta think about, man, when a person is just saying things, are they just like kind of like saying things like a chicken with its head cut off, or are they really looking at the etymology? See, this is something that I do, you know, and I know Alim does. Are they looking at the etymology of the words before they even saying stuff? Because when
no.
you look at it, yeah, you gotta think
no.
about it, man. If in North America the primary language is English, but where does English come from?
From all different languages.
Yeah, but yeah, Latin and Greek and yeah,
German.
Exactly. German, yeah. So there's, we gotta look at it. This whole thing, man, has been completely, you know, it's good that we, of course, understand English, of course, because, you know, I guess, you know, it'd be sounding really funny on this phone right now. I guess if we didn't. But it's just like some of these English words have Latin and Greek and different terminology that even sometimes sounds contradictory to what the original word means. Like, how are you going to tell somebody, you know, get blessed, and then the word blessed means blood sacrifice.
Right. You see the blood, yeah.
That's crazy.
You tell them you should be blessed, and then they'll say bless you. So many of them saying it, you know, especially among relatives, and you just said okay, you know, because actually it's almost useless to even try to talk to them or tell them or to debate with them, you know, to get them past that. You know,
yeah, I mean, maybe it's better to, I mean, you know, it just depends. I mean, maybe it's just better to say bless you or, you know, good one or, you know.
Right.
Something, you know, because I'm just saying when we use these words, they're like a spell. You know, grammar supposedly comes from the word grimoire, which means spell. You know,
mm-hmm.
So these spells, we have to be very conscious of the way that we speak, because we create our reality, you know, and that's
mm-hmm.
the whole law of attraction and all these things. But when you say these things and bring them to your conscious mind, and you say them over and over, you know, it gets into your subconscious mind, and then begins kind of creating the reality. But the thing is, people create these realities and they're unaware of when they're creating these realities. That's when, you know, there's the problem. That's why, you know, people are saying, you know, why can't I ever, you know, get a girlfriend, or why can't I ever, and the same person it's usually the person, like, rejecting, you know, this, you know, rejecting the first person that comes up, or the same, or the first man that comes up, or the first, you know, woman that comes up, or whatever. He's rejecting themselves.
Mm-hmm.
So, I mean, it's really, when we talk about it, it's just, understanding the etymology, understand where the word comes from.
Mm-hmm.
Was it used? Why is shit a bad word? What's bad about it? This is one of the things I had to realize in my own journey. What's bad about it? Every man, woman, animal, poop. Do they not? So how is that a bad word if it's a natural organic process that people do, or they should be doing, you know, on a daily basis? How is that a bad word?
So that's what they're trying to get people to believe or to think. You know.
Yeah.
What should be bad to, what they think that should be bad to you? You know.
I mean, it's good to know, you know, the difference between good and bad, of course, but how's piss a bad word? And yet you pee every day.
Right. They say that's vulgar. What they say, but they don't even know what the word vulgar means, really.
Mm-hmm.
Vulgar means the things of the common people, you know. What they call curse words.
Yeah, I don't see the curse that you're putting on someone when you pee.
Right.
When you pee every single day, you urinate.
Right.
You know,
right.
And some people even, you know, wipe their face or drink urine. So we can't look at this as something.
Yeah. Yeah, without unknowingly, you know.
That's exactly what I'm saying. That's where I feel the most problems come from, is the not aware of, you know, all the things that, you know, you didn't know. And I mean, that's, I feel, the first step of enlightenment is just knowing, okay, I really don't know as much as the universe, but I'm learning, you know, and doing my best, you know, and that's
right.
All I can do. But, I mean, so piss, shit, you know, ass, how are these, I mean, I'm just playing with words, but I'm just saying, how are these bad? You know, and then you're going to call, so you're going to tell me you don't insult a donkey?
That's what they say.
See, so these things are just, if you play with these words, they're contradictory. Hell comes from the word, you know, I believe that's Hellenistic. I believe that's Greek as well. And hell,
it's
really
from Saxon, hell, or what, hidden, or H-A-I-L, you know.
Hell.
I mean, hidden, or, you know, it's play of words, you know. And if you really don't really study etymology, you know, really everybody should study etymology on a serious basis.
Yeah, I mean, if you flip that around, you know, I think that, there's an AC/DC song they call Highway to Hell. But if you flip that around and say Highway to the Hill,
mm-hmm.
you could break that down in a certain way where it's just like, oh, the hill is representing the pineal gland. Yay! You know?
Mm-hmm.
Just by a changing of the word. So, it's just like, it's interesting. You know, we look at all these different things, and when you really look at these words and say, you know, I shouldn't say that word. Maybe I should. Maybe I should. You know, ever think about that? Just saying, when you catch yourself, oh, maybe I should say that word. And you go, maybe I should. You know?
Mm-hmm.
Maybe that make me stop being so afraid of it. You know, when you say the word shit, the sh sound has a healing sound on the liver.
Mm-hmm.
So, it has a healing sound on the liver. The body is even saying, hey, man, that, you know, that word isn't that bad, you know. The liver's saying that.
That's something?
Yeah. So that's why I say, once again, absorb what is useful. Disregard what is not. You know, I mean, certain words, man, I mean, the fuck word, the F-U-C-K.
Mm-hmm.
Tell me that people don't get filled with sexual energy at certain times when they hear that word.
They do, though.
They do? Yeah.
Some of them do, yeah.
When they hear it.
Well, to show you how much they have been, part of their mind controlling. You know, they've been through the newspapers, magazines, television,
videos,
music, you name it.
If you want to get off it completely, you have to say that one word, say particularly F-U-C-K, you have to say that that word, you know what I'm saying, I never use it, and I don't get aroused when I hear it, and I don't this, all that, if you want to completely eliminate it.
I know, I don't. No.
Oh, no, because, well, first of all, I heard it meant fornicate under the consent of the king. That's what I believe. And people get scared and, you know, they just say it's the F word. But
something like that, yeah.
But the F, you know, the F word, what is that F word that you're talking about? You know, the F-bomb. Oh, now it's brought terror to the place. It's a bomb now. See, this is just some nonsense.
Mm-hmm.
You see? And you'll know, I mean, some people may, I believe a psychologist said this before, that swearing actually in some way can be beneficial to the body because it allows you to kind of express words with more emotion. You heard this before?
No, not really.
This is what I believe. There was a psychologist that said this.
Hmm.
Now, if you swear to something, pinky swear, or if you swear to something, kind of like a bond, you see? So if you swear to something, you're kind of binded to something. So the word, swear words,
mm-hmm.
or curse words. You're not putting a curse on anyone. And like I said, some of these words that people use, you know, you could hear somebody say, "Oh, hell yeah," and that person is in a very joyful, you know what I'm saying, happy state. There's nothing wrong with that.
No.
They're in a cheerful state.
Let's say it's a play on words, like the word gay, you know. Originally it meant to be happy-go-lucky.
Gay?
Happy, yeah, gay. Mm-hmm. Happy-go-lucky person. Really, that doesn't really have anything to do with your sexual sexuality, not
okay.
like that.
Oh, okay.
Yes,
yeah. Yeah.
Yeah. Being homosexual, not like that.
Yeah, yeah, exactly. So, I mean, everything's been severely uprooted. If you watch this one documentary called, I believe it's called Chematica.
Mm-hmm.
And really interesting documentary. Talked about, you know, pretty much everything you could think of. But it goes in to say that the original tongue, you know, from the Helios Biblios,
mm-hmm.
From the original Hebrew text and the English text, have been severely uprooted making the languages incompatible. So, that just goes to show, even the interpretations are off.
Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah.
By miles.
Go back
They're
to the word
off.
Gay. Yeah.
Yeah, the word gay has been... See, the way that the vibrations of the words have used, people resonate with that vibration.
Mm-hmm.
So it's just like, when gay was something very happy-go-lucky, you know, it still is.
Mm-hmm. It still is, yeah.
It still is, but people have tried to put their own signal on it. See, that's the thing. People don't do the study, and then a new trend comes out, and then everybody's like, this is gay, that's gay, you know, that type of thing. And listen to the tone of their voice. That's gay. But you go, no, that's gay right there. You know, it's different.
Right.
Now, it's got nothing to do with homosexuality.
No, and none whatsoever. No. That's the word they use nowadays.
Even the word homo sapien, which is really like a funny, like, alien-like word to me, sounds like it was made by aliens or something. You know, but homo sapien, the word homo is in there.
Right.
So what are we really talking about? You know, there are people that have chemical imbalances, but like I said, we all come from the same source, you know, in that regard. So, it's like the whole indigo children, the whole concept is like, we're cleaning up everybody's shit, man. Everybody.
Mm-hmm.
We're clearing it up, bringing the darkness to the light, whatever topic is. Now, some of us will go in different paths, but whatever it is, it's religion, politics, you name it, race, whatever it is, we're here to bring the darkness to the light and bring at least the truth, you know, and bring that, you know, to the forefront. You know.
All right. We got 3 minutes before we go. We got three more minutes. Let me say this: the Empress, she passed this weekend. Empress Verdiasi, Washington Turner, Gaston El-Bey. She passed this past weekend, Saturday, April the 19th. That was on my born day. So not only did I have a great birthday, but also have one of the saddest days, too, based on our passing. Mm-hmm. So we're still receiving news on the updates on her being flown to Louisiana and if she's going to be buried, if there's going to be a burial or either she's going to be cremated. So we're still waiting to hear word on that. You can actually call the conference call numbers. If you go to Empire Washington, deduct the money, empirewashington.org, you can actually look up the information. You can actually speak with Frederick Joe Washington, the Empress's son, and call him. His number's at the bottom of the page and find out what's going on. So just keep that in mind.
First World Order Radio, finally, we are on the air, no doubt. All right.
There's always going to be somebody in the building on First World Order Radio.
We get on into some of that order consciousness tonight.
First World Order Radio every Wednesday, 8 p.m.
We got to talk about what is taking place on the planet.
There's always going to be somebody in the building on First World Order Radio. First, we need to let you know we're going to be doing more shows giving out more information on Wednesdays. Wednesday is 8 o'clock. We are now going to make this is the hottest day of the week.
Preceding others in time, order, importance. The most prominent parts, voices, or instruments. Earthly state of human concerns in existence. An indefinite multitude, quantity, or distance. System regulates to bring about specifics in the room based on value with natural characteristics. Current radiates electromagnetistics of sound through the air, same as your thoughts transmits it. Preceding others in time, order, importance. The most prominent parts, voices, or instruments. Earthly state of human concerns in existence. An indefinite multitude, quantity, or distance. System regulates to bring about specifics in the room based on value with natural characteristics. Current radiates electromagnetistics of sound through the air, same as your thoughts transmits it.
You need to understand how magical this, something like this every Wednesday can become. So you need to start getting your calendar right, get your schedule right. You need to know our intention straight out.
All right, so, I mean, these clues are given throughout the various languages was to piece the puzzle of this ancient mystery school back together again.
And what we plan on doing, both of us, is bringing y'all some surefire dynamite. We're going to take this level up a notch. We're going to have stuff to do here. This is not just going to be about philosophies and theories.